All right, welcome back. I hope you had a nice lunch. We have a terrific panel, and I'm going to follow Kenji's precedent and remind you that you have extensive bios in your conference book, so I'm not going to take any of our time. But just briefly, our speakers that's going to speak actually, oh, it's like reading from the bottom up, sort of. We'll start with Nan Strauss, the Director of Policy and Research from Choices in Childbirth, and Howard Minkoff, Distinguished Service Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology at SUNY Downstate and Chairman of Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Maimonides. And then Farah Diaz-Tello, Senior Staff Attorney at the National Advocates for Pregnant Women. And Dub Fox, Associate Professor of Law at the University of San Diego School of Law. And they're going to speak from, but each will speak from between 12 to 15 minutes. And then I think it's going to be very lively. And then we'll have a discussion. So, Nan.
Thanks, Carol. Hi, everyone. I want to start by really thanking the Carr Center and the Center for Reproductive Rights for bringing us all together and for bringing together a focus on birth, which is, of course, a form of reproduction that sometimes isn't talked about in the context of reproductive rights and even sometimes in reproductive justice. It's not always discussed, it's not always brought in the how of birth, even if we're talking about rights around birth. So I'm excited to be bringing those things together today. I'm now at Choices in Childbirth, but I came there from Amnesty International, and I want to start by talking about my work there and introducing the human rights framework into our discussion today. So I'm going to start by giving a background and overview that I think will carry through the discussion of all the panelists here. And I'm going to start with the human rights framework in the US, give some statistics and some information about the larger issues facing us in terms of birth and maternity care in the US, and then tell a story that hopefully will bring these issues to light, to life for everybody. So when I was starting at Amnesty, it was actually before we were doing work on maternal mortality. And as we got into that work, we were starting globally, and it was very important to prioritize bringing that lens of the human rights investigation back to a wealthy, developed country, not only focusing on the global South. And as soon as you start looking at global data, it becomes very clear what wealthy, developed country really needs to be put under scrutiny in terms of maternal health outcomes. The US spends more than any other country on maternity-related care, about twice what they spend in Europe, but we rank 65th in the world in terms of maternal deaths, and somewhere in the 30s for infant mortality. While those facts are true overall, while the outcomes are very poor overall, comparatively speaking, the risks are much greater for women of color, as is true, of course, across the board in our healthcare system. But in terms of maternal mortality, African American women nationally are 3 to 4 times as likely to die as are white women. And a report just came out from New York City looking at pregnancy-related deaths in the city over a new 5-year chunk of data that came out, finding that disparities have actually increased. And now in New York City, African American women are 12 times as likely to die from pregnancy-related causes as are white women. Asian American women are 4 times as likely, and Latinas 3 times as likely. And while deaths don't tell the full picture, maternal mortality is considered a bellwether indicator. It gives us a sense of how well the health system is working overall and suggests where there are gaps and where there needs to be greater attention. In addition to the deaths, though, there are sort of concentric circles that we need to look at moving outward. For every death, there are between 50 and 100 severe complications, near misses. And at this point, those have been going up, more than doubling since 1998. And at this point, one woman in the US nearly dies from a complication of pregnancy every 10 minutes. And I think it's shocking that both that is true and that this issue has flown under the radar for so long and so few people are aware that we're really not meeting the standards that we should be for our women. So why is this a human rights issue at all? Why isn't it just public health? Well, half of these deaths and complications approximately are considered preventable. And that's why we need to work on developing systems to ensure that everyone is getting the care that they deserve. So in bringing a human rights framework to these issues, we can look at the right to health, we can look at the right to life, the actual right to life of already living humans, and the right to be free from discrimination. And we also bring to it a framework that looks at non-discrimination and equity, the principles of active participation, and accountability in the system. Amnesty International's findings, through a great deal of research with people across the country, providers, women, support workers, indicate that there are problems in various areas, and it can be described by the human rights framework of the AAAQ, which is availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality of services. And this is a framework that's used widely globally, but it's just as relevant here, even though there may be differences of scale. So to talk about some of the findings, our system here suffers from multiple failures, including discrimination, financial, bureaucratic, and language barriers, a lack of information and participation in care, inadequate staffing, and quality protocols to ensure evidence-based practices, and a general lack of accountability and oversight. So how does that play out? Well, you see women going into pregnancy in ill health with chronic conditions based on the fact that they haven't had access to health care throughout their lives and because of the underlying determinants of health. They may live in a food desert where it's very difficult to get fresh produce and healthy foods. They may live in a community where it's difficult to have safe play spaces to be outside. All of these factors contribute to chronic conditions such as obesity, diabetes, hypertension, all of which affect a woman's ability to have a healthy pregnancy and birth and start way before she becomes pregnant. And she may have those conditions be untreated based on the fact that she doesn't have access to care. One in four women in this country still have delayed or no prenatal care, despite a long period of pushing for those numbers to improve. We also have problems with availability. Surprisingly to people in this city, I think, there are actual shortages of healthcare providers in this country, both primarily in rural areas, but also in medically underserved communities in urban areas as well. And it's about a fifth of the population of the country that lives in medical shortage areas. And federally qualified health centers, which are places that people can go to get care at no cost and they have to take all comers, those are only available to about 20% of those areas. There are particular shortages for women who need specialists, women who have complicated pregnancies, because Medicaid While Medicaid may cover the services, providers may not be willing to accept Medicaid rates for their services. It's also surprising to see that there's a growing shortage of obstetricians as people are retiring and fewer physicians are going into the profession. But what's also interesting is when you compare our country to other countries may have fewer obstetricians, but what they also have is a huge workforce of midwives who are the usual care providers for women with low-risk pregnancies. You also see in this country a lack of evidence-based practice in a lot of hospitals, and that's resulting in practices that expose women to greater risks in their pregnancies. For instance, the cesarean section rate in this country is now 33%, nearly. It's back to 32. But it's a third of all births. And while cesareans are life-saving surgeries for mothers and babies when needed, they also introduce risk. And if there's no benefit, if there's no evidence showing that a cesarean is going to provide a benefit in a particular set of circumstances, then it's going to impose those risks with no benefits, ultimately exposing women to additional risk of harm. There are also problems with decision making. In the legal context, we think about it as informed consent. And what we see through research, speaking with women at Amnesty, also at Choices in Childbirth, where I am now, there's not enough information. Women don't have a clear idea of a lot of the risks and benefits of some of the common decisions that they may have to make. And there also isn't consent, because very often the procedures to obtain consent are flawed whether someone is not asked, whether women are coerced against their will to go down a certain path, or whether it's simply an inappropriate time. Decisions need to be discussed before a woman is in labor for her to really be able to weigh the options in front of her. So I want to move from those concepts to talk about a story that illustrates how these issues play out in the US. I'm going to tell the story of one woman's experience with maternity care that's typical of what I hear at Choices in Childbirth in the research that we do. So this woman is not someone who's at added risk. She doesn't have health conditions. She's not low income. And she's very much like the people in this room. She's well-educated and has a planned pregnancy. She has no agenda with her birth. She just wants to have a healthy, pleasant birth. But she's afraid of needles and incisions, so she's going to do what she can to avoid them. She thinks that she might like a water birth because she knows that based on her comfort level, that would be the best option for her, she feels, to avoid an epidural and needles. So, but nowhere in the area offers water births. She goes from there to looking for a midwife, but when she calls to make an appointment between 8 and 10 weeks of pregnancy, no private practice midwives are available because everyone's already booked for her due date by 10 weeks pregnancy. She finds a hospital website that advertises a midwifery practice there, but when she calls the practice, she's told, oh, that's a clinic practice and they only can accept patients with Medicaid. She then goes down the list of about 10 doctors recommended by friends. Many don't take her insurance. Many don't take any insurance. Others have stopped doing births or are likewise already full. So keep in mind that she's doing this research while working at a full-time job where she hasn't told anyone about her pregnancy. She feels pressured to resolve the issue and so decides to sort of settle for an OB group where she feels that the care will be safe and acceptable, but really not in line with her values. But given her education, her experience, her socioeconomic position, she feels very confident in her ability to retain control over her decision making. So after the first prenatal visit, she finds that the visits are rushed and consist mainly of measuring her weight and blood pressure and spending about 5 or 6 minutes with the physician. near the end of her pregnancy, she goes over some succinct birth preferences, which are pretty much limited to she doesn't want needles, she wants to avoid an epidural and an IV, and she doesn't want incisions. She wants to avoid a cesarean and an episiotomy, which is an incision at the opening of the vagina. Unless there's a health concern, at which point, of course, she would reconsider. She requests that these notes be put in her chart. Labor begins at the hospital. They have a long wait in the hallway and in triage because labor and delivery is full at this large city hospital. Finally moved into labor and delivery, the nurse approaches to put in an IV, and the woman politely declines, but she's told she has to have one. Can't she wait until she actually needs the IV? No, no, it's hospital policy. Everyone has to have an IV. Being in labor, she's not certain that she can say no. And even if she was certain, does she really want to alienate and annoy the person who's going to be taking care of her and her baby for the next many hours? She's attached to continuous electronic fetal monitoring, but every time she gets up to move around, she disturbs the monitor contacts and is told to lie back down and stop moving so much. So left with no options for staying comfortable, she gets an epidural despite considerable anxiety. She has a reaction. It makes her shake uncontrollably, adding to her anxiety and that of her partner. She reminds the doctor and nurse, though, once again, even in her state of anxiety, that she does not want surgery and she does not want an episiotomy. But after reaching full dilation and pushing for an average amount of time, there are no signs that anything is troubling, but the doctor threatens her, if you can't push this baby out in the next 15 minutes, I'm prepping you for a section. She remains determined, I'm just gonna pick up more. Yes. She remains determined and continues to push, but she hears the sound of instruments on a tray and feels that the doctor's cutting an episiotomy. She focuses on the baby, and because it wasn't her doctor but a colleague in the practice, she never sees that physician again to find out why an episiotomy was needed and why it was needed to be done without consent. The baby's taken from the parents after a few short minutes together. The mother asks her partner repeatedly to do whatever it takes to get the baby back, but to no avail. They get the baby back 4 hours later. Her postpartum care has an equal number of mishaps, but because I'm needing to move on, I will let you imagine them. She is made to feel very embarrassed by her breasts being exposed while she's breastfeeding. It's not really encouraging evidence-based practices. But I just want to say quickly what the aftermath of this is. The mom considers complaining about the unconsented episiotomy. She doesn't have the energy. She's exhausted. She is a colicky baby. And when she asks her own newborn, when she asks her own doctor about what happened at her 6-week visit, she's told, well, how would I know why he did that? I wasn't there. And at her next appointment, when she reports having continuing pain at the incision site, her doctor says, well, there really isn't anything I can do about that. So that's the end of the story, but I want to bring it back and just say, we often hear, well, just be grateful you have a happy baby. I mean, you have a healthy baby and you're all home, healthy, happy, and safe. And that's a pretty low bar. If women are expected to be grateful that they are alive, that their baby is alive, in the country where we spend more on maternity care than anywhere else in the world, I think we're really doing a disservice to women. And that's why it brings it back to why we're here talking about these issues together and incorporating the work of National Advocates for Pregnant Women, Choices in Childbirth, and Reproductive Rights and Reproductive Justice, because this needs to be brought back to the woman, what her experience is, what her rights are, and what we need to do to work together to improve the conditions for women across the board at all stages of their reproductive life. Thanks.
Let me just say for the record that I was not the obstetrician of record in that particular case.
True.
I am a physician here, and I'm getting acute PowerPoint withdrawal at the moment because I'm not used to speaking without looking over my shoulder to see what I'm supposed to be saying. But I am glad to follow Nan because I'm also going to try to do both the 30,000-foot view of what goes on in obstetrics and the granular view that we see every day on the wards. And this is going to be from an ethical framework. Any overlap with law is absolutely coincidental. But I wanted to, first of all, what are my qualifications? I used to have a member of my department who played the violin. I used to say to him, how good are you at that thing? You take every vacation, you go to violin camps. Are you really a good violinist? He said, well, among the obstetricians, I'm one of the best violinists. Among the violinists, I'm one of the best obstetricians. That's my relationship to ethics, more or less. But I want to start off by getting you involved and using a couple of perhaps the most well-known thought experiments in moral philosophy, just to get a starting point that I think will be relevant. Philippa Foot was a British moral philosopher, and in 1964 she came up with this thought experiment. As an interesting aside, she was the grandchild of two American presidents, the 22nd and 24th. Any historians in the audience? It's the only president we had who was president twice, separated by one term. Grover Cleveland. Very good. In any case, she conjured up this trying to find some universals. She had this thought of a train going down a track. I'm sure you've heard of trolleyology. Going down a track where there are five little girls tied to the track. They're gonna die because the train's out of control. The engineer has died. But you notice at the last minute you're standing on the side, there's a switch. If you pull the switch, it moves to another track where there's one lone man walking down the track. Pull the switch, man dies, girls live. Don't pull the switch, girls die, man lives. How many people in this audience, be honest, pull the switch, save the five girls? Raise your hand. All right, so you're like most of the world. This has been done thousands of times. The majority pull the switch. You are, by definition, utilitarians, the greatest good for the greatest number. You're not categoricalists. You're not Kant. Don't have Asperger's. You're okay. I don't know. Those of you who didn't pull it, don't take it personally. But let's move to the second, which was actually Judith Jarvis Thompson's ad. So now there's the same setup. The girls are on the track. The train's going to kill them. But now there's no second track. And you're on a transom looking down, and you notice standing next to you is a man. He happens to be a fat man. There was a book last year, Would You Kill a Fat Man? The reason he has to be fat is because otherwise you could say, I'll jump and stop the train, but you're too thin. You need a fat man next to you. And you realize you give him a little tap, he'll fall over the transom, he will stop the train. How many of you utilitarians will take the same bargain? You say, five girls, you kill one man. How many people push? This is also fairly standard. The majority don't switch. Suggesting there's a lot of, we can get into what Thomas Aquinas said, but suffice it to say, for many people, it's the thought of touching, and we act differently when we're close to the moral event. The other philosophy story I want to tell you is from Peter Singer, who last night, Dr. Loft thought I said Pete Seeger, no, Peter Singer, who tells a story about a woman who's walking down the street, and she sees a little girl drowning in a 6-inch pool of water. She starts to run over to pull the girl out of the water, and she suddenly thinks, oh my God, I've got my favorite shoes on. These are very expensive Manolo Blahniks. Is that the right name? Yes. I can't ruin my shoes. So she lets the girl drown. How many people think that's the worst thing in the world? She's moral, right? Moral problem. How many people think it's the same thing if you bought the shoes in the first place rather than send the money to Africa to save children by getting malaria in it? Peter Singer says they are exactly the same thing. But somehow we don't, I don't see anybody here with bedraggled clothing because every time you went to the store, you thought, I could spend this money better by sending it overseas. So all of us make different judgments depending on whether it's right in front of us or it's something abstract. And I bring this up because last week, same day, I was lecturing at the Hilton. They had the district meeting of all the obstetricians from New York State. Not Mississippi, not Alabama, New York State. There were over 200, and they had those little audience response clickers so you could ask questions and see the actual numbers. And so I asked them, tell me, who has the greatest rights among these people? A fetus, a child, a pregnant woman, a mother, a dead man? Now the answers were pretty much what you'd like to see, that the pregnant woman had the most rights, then the new mother, then the child, then the dead man, then the fetus. So they were not prioritizing the fetus over the mother. But when you then ask them to address a scenario, imagine the woman is in labor. full-term, healthy baby, cord prolapses, the baby's going to die soon unless you do an emergency cesarean section. The woman refuses for, quote-unquote, seemingly trivial reasons. There's a judge standing nearby, said, you want a court order? You can have a court order. Rumor has it, it's not that tough to get a court order to save a baby in the middle of the night. You just find some judge and they're going to do it. So how many of you would do a cesarean section without consent? It was about 82%, or something like that. High number, almost everybody. If you then said, suppose the baby is now alive, and an hour later it turns out it has some mysterious illness that will cause its death shortly, unless it gets a marrow, and the only matching marrow in the world is the mother's. Mother refuses for seemingly trivial reasons. How many people get that court order now to take the mother's marrow? Much, much fewer, only about a third. So they're somehow willing to do a more invasive procedure on someone they said had more rights to protect someone they said had the fewest rights. And perhaps most embarrassing at all, being that I'm also a member of the guild, they were more likely to get a court order to do a cesarean section than to take a kidney from a dead man to save a child. So from a perspective of my colleagues, we do react differently in the abstract and the real. But I will tell you personal experience about the difference. One of the great honors of my life has been to work in the shadow of Lynn Paltrow and have my name on some papers she wrote. And we've written the papers about women who had cesarean sections coerced without consent. And we would often festoon the discussion with cases. And by the way, it was interesting for me this morning as a physician to sit in the back behind the bushes there looking like at a different tribe and how the tribe speaks. And you're all people of the book. You cite this, I cite that, you cite this. But so we were citing all these cases where women, court orders were gotten, but the woman escaped from the hospital, went to some other hospital, and had a happy ending. But I would say defending autonomy by saying women have a right to make correct decisions is shooting fish in a barrel. The real issue is, do you defend a woman's right to make stupid decisions? Stupid being defined as different than my own. But I have had cases, I know I look remarkably young, but I've had cases in my life, and the hospital where I work is the busiest obstetrical service in the state. We have almost 9,000 births a year, so it's a lot of births over a long period of time, where I knew that bad things were going to happen to the baby. I know I'm fallible. I know I make mistakes. David Grimes can tell you the confidence interval around the frequency of my mistakes is pretty large. But there are times you can be pretty certain. This tracing is awful. This blood pressure is awful. The size of the baby is awful. Bad things. This baby's going to die soon if we don't do something. And despite my obvious eloquence, I could not convince the woman. I told her it's her choice. We'll respect whatever she wants. We're not getting a court order. You're the boss. But this is why they pay me the big bucks, so I can tell you what I think is in your best interest. And I feel strongly. I will beg you. Let us deliver this baby. It is going to die. And I remember this vividly. She's there with her sister. Her sister says, don't do it. They're all blah, blah, blah. And we have a cousin that had the same story. They told her she had to have it, and everything worked out fine. So I said, could you leave the room? Did the same thing. Anything I could didn't work. She went home. She came back the next day with a dead baby, dead fetus, whatever you want to call it. The point is that I did not get great solace from the fact that a principal lived so this baby could die or vice versa, but that's not important. What's important is she didn't feel good that baby died so a principal could live. She was distraught, and I'm sure to this day she is not the same person because that happened. So it is difficult to deal with, and I have colleagues of mine, in print we argue with each other all the time, who do cesarean sections proudly without consent and always tell me the next day the woman thanks them. So it's a different thing. I have no problem believing fully in my heart that women have a right to refuse, but that doesn't make it an easy decision for them, certainly. For me, perhaps less so. So it made me start to think, what is this thing? What is this thing in the uterus that makes us think of it different ways in different circumstances? And I decided this is like Schrodinger's cat. I don't know how many of you know this. You're probably better at metaphysics than physics. I certainly am. But Schrodinger basically was debunking a school of physics. He was a Nobel laureate in the 1930s that said that quantum particles could exist in two states at the same time. And to debunk it, he came up with this Rube Goldberg of an idea of a cat in a box with a small piece of radiation where an atom might or might not be released. If it was released, the cat would die. If not, it would live because it was cyanide somehow. So people outside the box at any given moment would think the cat is alive or dead. And he, based on this, there was a famous poster of Schrodinger's cat, dead and alive. So the thought experiment I came up last week, I asked the members in the audience this question. I said, imagine a woman comes back, she was doing God's work in Liberia fighting Ebola. She couldn't get good prenatal care there, there's no ultrasound machine, so she came back at 23 weeks, the only American woman at 23 weeks not to have a sonogram. And she immediately got a sonogram, and it revealed a lesion in the back of the neck of the child. The child would be paraplegic. No arm movement, no leg movement for its entire life. She turns to the obstetrician and said, I can't go on with this pregnancy. And I asked the audience, how many of you would do an abortion or refer her for an abortion if you don't do it? 96% said they would. I said, okay. The woman said to you, you misunderstood me. I said, I could not go on with this pregnancy. I don't want an abortion. I want to be induced. I want this baby delivered now. And you say, but now the baby not only is going to be paraplegic, but at 23 weeks, even though it's a legal abortion, that baby's good chance of survival. But if it does, overwhelming likelihood of blindness, deafness, cerebral palsy, severe impairment. She said, I don't care. Induce it. I asked the audience, would you induce it? No. So what is this? It's the same thing, same moment, same place that you're willing to terminate but not willing to harm. And so I've tried in my own way to figure out what is this, what are the rights, and we had a little conversation with Lynn, who is hating me at the moment in the back, about how we should view this sort of thing, and she mentioned that there is a different view to a baby as it goes forward. There is a movement towards moral agency at some pace. What I would say is that movement never reaches the point at which a woman's negative autonomy can be questioned. It never reaches the point where you can test her for drugs against her will. If you want to protect babies from the ravages of drugs and you want to do drug testing, test the doctors who take care of them. Don't test the mother. She'll get more benefit. So you can't do cesarean sections. You can't incarcerate. You can't do that. Those things. But you can start to question affirmative autonomy. If a woman has voice says to me, I want this child. And then she said, and I want my cesarean, my repeat section at 29 weeks because my cousin is coming in from Peru. I'm going to say, I won't do it. That baby will be harmed, and I will not be party to the harm because I also have a right to refuse. So that, I think, is what the decision that the mother makes, that's the role that it has. And that role goes prior to viability. If any of you have little girls in the house, if you take your daughter today to the pediatrician and say, I have a relative with breast cancer, I want my daughter tested for BRCA, the American Academy of Pediatrics is going to say to you, we won't do it. That's such a weighty decision, and there's nothing we can do to prevent cancer. We'll wait till she's 18, she makes her own decision. If that baby is in utero, and you say to your obstetrician, I want an amniocentesis to see if my baby is BRCA, they're going to say to you, why do you want to know? If you want to know because you're going to abort the baby if it's positive, fine. There's your amnio. If you say, I want it just because I want to know what my baby has, they'll say, sorry, you have to wait till the baby is born, reaches 18, and then can choose for themselves. So we're already deciding, is that thing inside of you a fetus or is it a potential child? Once the toll occurs, and the toll is not an atom being released in a box, it's the mother saying, I want this baby to be born, I do not want a termination. There is a different moral calculus. So let me end on time.
Yeah,
on time.
Amazing.
Let me just end by saying that no one other than Lynn speaks as eloquently for pregnant women and their children than pregnant women, and that we have to, those are the voices that we need to listen to. Sometimes it's not easy, but I think that's where we need to be. Thank you.
So as Dr. McGuff said, we are a tribe. We communicate in certain ways, and I believe that the law fundamentally is about storytelling. So I want to start with a story, and it's a true story. As opposed to Schrodinger's cat. Yeah. So this is the story of a woman named Renate Dre. She is a mother in Brooklyn. She had had her first two children by cesarean surgery, and as an Orthodox Jewish woman who wanted to have as many children as possible, she knew that having a third repeat cesarean surgery would be dangerous to her. In fact, the dangers of cesarean surgery increase with each successive surgery. So she was highly motivated to have a vaginal birth after cesarean section, or as it's known, a VBAC. And so Thanks to the work of Choices in Childbirth, among other groups, she had access to information to figure out which hospital in New York City was most likely to honor her decision to have a vaginal birth after cesarean, where would she be most likely to find support for her decisions in birth. And she came to the decision to deliver at Staten Island University Hospital. And that's not a small thing, to go from Brooklyn to Staten Island in labor. So she managed to find a supportive obstetrician, but when the day came for her to actually make the journey from Brooklyn to Staten Island in labor, the doctor who had supported her wishes was not there. And when she showed up, the person who was there, the first thing he said to her was, "You've already had two. Why don't you just have another surgery right now?" And she requested more time to labor, and she did so with the support of a doula, a labor assistant who's a non-medical practitioner, and her family. But unfortunately, her labor didn't progress on the timeline that the hospital would have preferred. So the obstetrician told her, "I'm not going to examine you. I'm not going to do anything further for you unless you consent to have cesarean surgery right now." And she said, "No, I want more time to continue to labor." And so the obstetrician brought in a maternal fetal medicine specialist. And the maternal fetal medicine specialist told her, "You should have cesarean surgery." And she said, "No, I would like some more time to labor." So at this point, and this is clearly documented in her medical records, the maternal fetal medicine specialist documented the patient has decisional capacity to decide whether or not to have surgery. We've decided to override her decision to refuse a C-section, and hospital counsel is in agreement. So with that, they wheeled Miss Dre to have an unconsented cesarean surgery as she continued to protest and beg them not to perform the surgery, completely unconsented. Now the surgery, which was supposed to put a quick end to her labor, instead ended up being a fight for her life. They bisected her bladder, that meant cut through it entirely, and she almost died on the table, and they had to spend 5 hours trying to save her life. And in fact, she was told later on that if she had been any older or in any poorer health, she wouldn't have survived the incident. She did give birth to a healthy baby, but to this day, she continues to experience pain because of the injury, in addition to the trauma that she suffered from having to undergo an unconsented surgery. As I said, she's more informed than most. She knew where to look to find a supportive provider for a VBAC. She had access to a doula, which many people, even here in New York City, don't. And she had the support of her family. So her mother actually pulled the fetal heart tracing, the readout from the monitor that had been on her, out of the trash can because they thought they might need it later. Her doula knew to call Choices in Childbirth to find out what they should do. In fact, they called us very, very early on in the case, and we referred them to an attorney. But even with all of this, even with all of the things in her favor, the hospital managed to drag things out for long enough, and she had such difficulty finding an attorney who would take her case that she exceeded the statute of limitations for battery. So for the lawyers in the audience, an unconsented medical touching or unconsented touching of any sort is a battery, but they have managed now to exceed her statute of limitations. So she has ended up filing a lawsuit against the hospital and against the physicians who did this to her, and it is in general a malpractice suit, claiming that unconsented care can't be care that is within the good and acceptable standard of medical care. And the hospital's response was shocking, but maybe unsurprising. They responded, "We battered her, so we didn't commit malpractice. So her suit is not timely. She's exceeded her statute of limitations." They also said that this raised thorny political issues, and that if Ms. Dre wanted to claim that pregnant people have a right to refuse unwanted cesarean surgery, they should get a law passed that said that. That this was a case begging for a legislative solution, but not one for the courts. And furthermore, New York recognizes tort liability for harm to fetuses that are later born alive. And so the hospital and obstetricians argued that this potential liability creates not only a right, but a duty for the obstetrician to supersede the refusal of an unconsenting patient and to uphold the state's interest in the protection of fetal life. So there were a volley of motions for summary judgment on both sides, and the court recently entered an interim ruling. And in part, the court said that she's a bit out of luck, because even though New York courts have recognized that people have an almost sacrosanct right to decline unwanted medical treatment, that appellate courts have never specifically held that pregnant people in particular have a right to refuse surgery that a doctor can't override. And in so doing, it cited the state's abortion, self-abortion law, which is still in the New York Penal Code, and it cited Roe versus Wade. And the court also found that this extrajudicial deprivation of liberty, which was done with no court order, no attempt at a court order even, and a literal invasion of Ms. Dre's body, isn't sufficient for summary judgment because there still remain factual issues to be resolved, namely whether or not she was actually putting her fetus at risk and whether or not she herself was at risk, essentially suggesting that pregnant people are the only class of persons who can be forced into unwanted procedures for their own good. So two things really stand out about this case. I guess the first one, or a precursor to that, the zeroth thing that stands out about this case is not that it happened, but that it has ever come to light. That all of the advantages that I named of her knowledge and resources here in New York City have led her to be able to take action in this case. So the first thing that stands out is that in the filings, it came to light that the hospital did what they did pursuant to a hospital policy. That in fact, in some building somewhere in Staten Island, in a building that actually was destroyed by Sandy, that there exists a hospital policy for Staten Island University Hospital that lays out the steps by which they deprive their pregnant patients of their right to refuse unwanted surgery. It essentially says if you have somebody who is refusing surgery, first you try to convince them, and if you don't manage to convince them, then you do a psychiatric evaluation to determine their competency, and if they continue to refuse, you do the surgery anyway. That's it. There's no, at no point in the steps that are laid out in that policy is there the idea that a person has the right to make decisions that are contrary to medical opinion. The other thing about this case is that it clearly shows the failure of the state to protect individuals from harm by institutions and private actors, which is a critical point of interest for reproductive justice. The hospital's skipping of any sort of legal process puts this into the realm of private harms, to where the Constitution doesn't reach. So these fundamental questions of reproductive justice are being hashed out in Brooklyn Supreme by a couple of malpractice guys with a small firm. And with the assistance of their scrappy amici, who are mostly run by volunteer moms. And in a way, this is the purpose of the system of civil justice, to redress private harms. But as reproductive justice advocates, we should reject the proposition that reproductive freedom must be litigated case by case in Brooklyn Supreme or anywhere else. And this is in part because of the barriers to justice that exist for people giving birth. And many of them have to do with social factors, the first of which is a lack of awareness that there has been a legal violation in the first place. We hear from many people who recognize that something wrong happened to them, but didn't realize that the something wrong that happened to them might also be a violation of their rights. And this is in part because of the social expectations that a woman should give up anything, her health, her dignity, and even her life itself, if it means giving birth to a healthy baby. There are also institutional barriers, hospitals unwilling to give the medical records to patients who later come back and have questions. And in fact, many women who are trying to figure out to piece together what happened to them are met with an iron curtain, are told that they can't have access to that information, that they have to pay money to get access to the information about what happened to them. and find that nobody will provide them the answers until they come back with the power of discovery. And last of all, there is the issue of access to attorneys who will even take these cases. Ms. Dre's attorney, Michael Bast of Silverstein and Bast, who is an amazing fellow, in deciding whether or not to take the case, workshopped it with many other attorneys, and everybody told him, don't take this case, it's a loser. Even though she has a cognizable injury in the bladder injury, you shouldn't take this case. And in fact, one attorney, a female attorney, told him, I hate her. I hate your client. Why didn't she just do it? Why didn't she just have the surgery when they told her to? So it all comes back again to the social expectations of what it is that someone who's giving birth is expected to sacrifice in the name of a healthy infant. And, you know, in fact, I've been told by opposing counsel in these cases, I'd rather defend a battery than a malpractice case that could bankrupt this hospital. So that is a great opportunity for me to talk a little bit about the role of malpractice in all of this. You know, we are told that the surgeon cesarean sections is of women's own doing, that if women stopped suing, the doctors would stop cutting. And, you know, to some extent, it may be true that the rise in cesarean sections may be related to malpractice concerns. But the response to a malpractice fear is not a human rights violation upon another person. Professor Gilligan has challenged us to think about where women's voices are in all of this. And here, quite literally, they're silenced and even excised from the law. We often hear from doctors who tell us glibly, of course we would never do an unwanted cesarean section. Wouldn't that be a criminal assault with a deadly weapon? Ha ha ha. Well, try telling that to a prosecutor. And in fact, many women have and have been rebuffed and said, no, in fact, there is a legal exception to the law that you're trying to encourage us to use against the people who did this to you that says that if it was done for medical purposes, it's not an assault. So you're going to hash this out in tort. And then there is the problem that reproductive and psychological harms are, that there is jurisprudential contortionism to try to prevent people from getting compensation in those cases. Obstetric violence in the United States exists in the liminal space where domestic violence and sexual assault existed in the 1950s, in the shadows where the law doesn't reach. And I'm sure the response in many people's minds is hashtag not all doctors, right? Obviously, Dr. Minkoff being case in point, the vast majority of people who go into obstetrics do so with pure intention for the love of birth and birthing women and babies. And not all of them commit these acts on their patients, just as not all men batter, just as not all men rape. But the mark of our society is how we respond when they do. Will our courts defend dignity, or will they facilitate coercion and violence? The promises of the Constitution were not meant for people who look like me, not only as a woman of color, but as somebody who's given birth to three children. The law has been built and grown to include women, people of color, and LGBT folks, and indeed the people who exist at the intersections of these. The task of reproductive justice lawyers is to build the law, and now to include birthing people too.
Well, it's a special pleasure to be here with you all today and get to share in this exchange of ideas. I'm enormously grateful to Sally and Diana, the Center for Reproductive Rights and the Carr Center, for having me for this extraordinary, if all too bracing, event. I want to shift the conversation a bit from intentional to unintentional practices of reproductive medicine and technology. The thoughts that I want to share with you are new ones for me, and so I'm going to be reading for the most part from the pages that are in front of me. I will try to look up every so often to give the appearance of spontaneity. constitutional rights jurisprudence that teaches us that the government inflicts reproductive harm by imposing restrictions on the freedom to prevent or terminate a pregnancy. But for those who turn to healthcare professionals to help them realize their reproductive goals, private negligence that takes form in bungled vasectomies, lost gametes, and switched embryos can deprive people of control over procreation as much as any government ban. The hundreds of legal cases that result from such wrongdoing can be distinguished by three reproductive goals that misconduct thwarts in each. In the first category of cases, it imposes pregnancy or parenthood on people who sought to avoid these roles. In the second category of cases, it deprives those who wanted offspring of these very same opportunities. And in the third, it disrupts efforts to have or avoid having children of a particular type. Let me give you examples of each of these. First, procreation imposed. These are all not just real cases, but among the many hundreds of them, very recent ones from just the last couple of years. Procreation was imposed when a couple discovered that they were carriers of the sickle cell trait when their first child was born with that disorder. So the woman had surgery to close her fallopian tubes in hopes they would avoid having another child affected by the disease. Her doctor left one of her tubes open, however, leading them to have a second child who was also born with the disease. The second category is procreation deprived. A couple had their egg and sperm combined and frozen in preparation for IVF treatment. They had sought IVF instead of gamete donation or adoption because they wanted their resulting child to be genetically related to both of them. When they sought to use the resulting embryos to do so, however, the clinic informed them that their embryos were gone, quote, lost or destroyed or implanted in other parties. Procreation disrupted. A couple that wanted a child learned that they were at risk of transmitting a serious X-linked disorder that affects only boys. So they created embryos in order to single out just the female embryos to implant. But a clinic mix-up led them to have a boy who was born with the disease. Now, lest you think these cases are aberrations, they are not. Reproductive medicine and technology of the kind that I'm going to discuss today are altogether unregulated. And accordingly, errors like these are far too common. Now, in these cases that I've divided into procreation imposed, procreation deprived, and procreation disrupted, courts almost uniformly, not just in the three I mentioned, but in all those like them, dismiss these suits outright. Or, if they allow them even to proceed, they refuse to award any damages. Now, they have little trouble, the courts in these cases, finding that negligence on the part of the healthcare practitioners was to blame. The problem is that our law lacks a category of injury that's fitted to the wrongful frustration of control over reproduction. Interests in romantic intimacy, like those emphasized in Griswold, lose their purchase when reproduction moves out of the bedroom and into the laboratory, as does an interest in bodily integrity like those emphasized in the abortion cases when wrongdoing involves no physical harm, no unconsented touch, no privacy intrusion. That our legal system, therefore, neither deters such wrongs, however egregious, nor compensates its victims, however aggrieved, exposes new fault lines in the jurisprudence of reproduction. What we have today is a reproduction law of liberty rights, in that it protects only the abstract capacity for freedom. It says that government can't ban or restrict too severely people's rights in the abstract to prevent or terminate a pregnancy, even if the absence of bans leaves them, by virtue of poverty or other limitations, altogether incapable of actually exercising those freedoms. The challenge of reproductive negligence puts into sharp relief the need for the opposite kind of right, namely claim rights, to actually realize these freedoms. The claim right that I have in mind here would entitle victims of reproductive negligence to impose duties of competent care on those professionals who assume a duty to care for their interests in making decisions about procreation. Neither contract law nor property law can, I think, protect this right, because the injuries at stake aren't captured by broken agreements or damaged possessions. The law of torts holds more promise for resolving these disputes, but existing tort remedies are inadequate. The actions we call wrongful life or wrongful birth or wrongful pregnancy remedy exclusively physical or economic harms, medical or child-rearing costs associated with negligence. What they don't remedy is the intangible injury that is the wrongful denial of control over one's reproductive life, precisely the deep injury that I think is most saliently at stake in the cases that I've described. Victims of procreative negligence aren't complaining that their child is undesired or undesirable. It's that they've been robbed of their capacity to determine whether to gestate a fetus or raise a child. And decisions about having children matter in a special way. They forge our core identities and aspirations more than almost any other purpose that we commit to or role that we assume. More than maybe any decision in our lives, besides perhaps the person we choose to marry, they drive who we are and how we live, how we want to be remembered, and what other things we can do with our lives. Reproductive decisions have a unique power to enrich or smother romantic intimacy, to affirm or impede family belonging, to enable or quash outside pursuits. The profound influence that these decisions have on our experience of our lives warrants their protection against the wrongful frustration of these decisions as an injury in itself. Now, the level of recovery that would be fitting for a jury to award for a violation of this interest under the right that I'm proposing, this claim right to procreation, would depend on the extent to which wrongfully thwarted efforts do actually impair individual well-being in these senses, and on the probability that it's the professional wrongdoing that was responsible for those injuries. I'll suggest in a moment some other things that might be at work here. So let's see how these considerations would play in the three categories of reproductive negligence with which I began. First, where reproductive negligence imposes unwanted pregnancy or parenthood, the procreation right would protect against the denial of control over people's decisions to avoid these roles. Recognizing this injury as one in itself frees courts from having to adjudicate whether plaintiffs would have sought an abortion had they had information available to them that the doctor should have given them, or whether a child was himself harmed by negligence without which he would not have existed. These, of course, are the very kinds of hurdles that courts use to deny recovery under existing tort actions. These would not present hurdles under the procreation right if we recognize as an injury in itself the wrongful denial of control over decisions independent of child rearing or other sorts of expenses.
In these procreation imposed cases, larger awards might accompany failed sterilizations through which patients sought to avoid having a child they couldn't afford in more permanent ways, forever. Lesser awards accordingly might attach to the frustration of less reliable or less permanent forms of birth control. Likewise, lesser recovery might attach to the implantation of additional embryos where at least one child was already planned. These cases are ones where a couple says, hey, we want one child and we want you to implant one embryo, but the doctors then implant two or three, leading to, say, triplets. I think that would certainly an imposition of procreation that violates a core interest, but that injury might be lesser by comparison to one where no child was planned at all, like the failed tubal ligation, and they get one in the first place. These are just hunches through which juries might use to measure the severity of harm at stake. In the second category of cases, when procreative negligence deprives the chance for wanted pregnancy or parenthood, the right vindicates the lost ability to pursue procreation. Here, a more severe kind of injury would be a more permanent, again, kind of injury, leaving patients ever to conceive at all, by comparison, perhaps, to a more temporary or less full kind of deprivation, losing just some of a couple's embryos and not all of them, for instance. Clinics should also, I said, be held responsible only for the extent to which their negligence is what dashes legitimate reproductive expectations. Even when fertility treatment goes right, we should keep in mind success rates for patients are low, and they become predictably lower with age. Damages would, in these cases, accordingly be discounted by the probability that infertility or some other cause would have led to the same result by which procreation was deprived, even in the absence of any wrongdoing. Finally, reproductive negligence disrupts people's efforts to have offspring of particular types when their sperm or eggs are from the wrong donor are used, or when the wrong embryos are implanted into the wrong person, or gametes, embryos, or fetuses are misdiagnosed for selected conditions. That injury tends to be most serious for negligently frustrated efforts to select offspring's traits of heredity and health that tend to have more significant impacts on people's experiences of parenting. Thwarted trait preferences could merit lower awards, by contrast, when professional misconduct foils attempts to produce a child of a particular sex or looks or smarts, for the same reason that these tend to impact parenting experiences by comparison less. And plaintiffs could still rebut such presumptions of lesser recovery in the cases that I suggested by showing how their reasons for having preferred those particular offspring traits justify higher damage awards in their cases. And the only time when they wouldn't be at liberty to do so is where a judge found that such disruption was unremediable altogether based on policy grounds. One such case we might consider is one recent one involving race selection, where a white couple chose a white donor and got a donor who was black. In any case, they weren't going to have their child wouldn't be genetically related to them. The switch was not between a spouse and a stranger, but rather one donor who was white and another who was black. Now, our law today treats reproductive negligence among life's vicissitudes, like star-crossed lovers or hapless rolls of the genetic dice for which no one is responsible, leaving victims to steel themselves against its profound effects on their lives. Calling back to Sally Burns' call and her opening remarks, I believe it's time for the law to recognize that control over pregnancy and parenting decisions are distinct and serious interests. And the claim right I've introduced here would shift the baseline for actionable reproductive negligence from whatever fallouts nature occasions, that's what we have today, to the outcomes that advances in medicine and technology make it reasonable for people to expect. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, all four of you. It seems to me we have a lot to talk about. It's right? So I think we should go right to the audience, and then you can jump in if you want to talk to each other, too. Questions? Yes. Can you hear her in the back? Ah, help is on the way.
Hi, thank you for that wonderful panel. I'm wondering if a few of you can say a little bit more about malpractice insurance and how you think it does or does not play in to the problems. I was really struck by what Farah said, that even if malpractice insurance makes C-section surgery more likely, that doesn't make it okay to perform surgery without consent. But I'm still kind of curious about that. Is that true? And what can be done about it? And I guess for Dove, I was just thinking, it made me think, here's a whole new area, obviously, that medical professionals can be sued, which I think is the point of your paper. But would they have to have more extensive malpractice insurance, et cetera? Would it make ART more expensive?
A few years ago, there was a consensus development task force by the Public Health Service. I think it was on VBAC, and I was asked as a member of the panel to discuss the effect, the degree to which the malpractice crisis changed cesarean section rates. And in fact, it's very little. If you look at people in a given zip code in Texas versus another neighboring zip code in Texas and try to correlate malpractice rates with cesarean section rates, there's a temporary tick up in the doctor. All the other doctors in the hospital who share in the pain and the experience for a while will become defensive. But it didn't have a major play. It is spiritually debilitating to be sued. More than the money, it really causes serious depression and other things. Physicians do believe they're trying to do the best thing. Again, we're all fallible, we make mistakes, and our current system is designed to compensate and deter. I will say it doesn't do either well. I know if I'm the best obstetrician in the world and I have a baby that weighs 8.5 pounds, there's about a 2% chance of shoulder dystocia. Of those, 10% will have injury and 10% will have permanent injury. If I have been sued for doing it, and I know my next baby has the exact same rate, I may think that maybe I'll be a little bit more persuasive about going to the operating room because of the pain of going through the tort system. But it doesn't seem to have as much of an effect as you hear about in the lounges of obstetricians, labor and delivery suites.
I have another thought about that, and I'd be interested to hear your feedback. My concern is that there's a difference between expecting physicians to behave as rational economic actors and the influence of a perhaps not rational concern, because I'm familiar with what you're talking about as far as there not being a direct relationship between greater amounts of damages being awarded and various vicissitudes of the system over different places and times. But at the same time, you do hear a lot of stories about people talking about their colleagues or overhearing people saying, you don't get sued for the cesarean, you do.
That's right.
Dot, 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 you only get sued for the ones you don't do. And so even if it's not rational or not based in fact, the fear is not based on the difference in damages or I think that the concern about being sued itself is enough to put that psychological pressure on people.
I don't disagree at all. There is an old adage, the only cesarean session you regret is the one you didn't do in the long run. So it definitely is part of your thought process, but hopefully at a conscious level, you're able to overcome that and do what you think is in the best interest. So. There's an old rule that we're taught, practice good medicine, keep good records, get a good lawyer,
The other thing to keep in mind, too, is that the proffered solution, generally tort reform, and I think the VBAC consensus panel of the NIH recommended tort reform, doesn't solve the problem. In Texas, which has a very harsh tort cap, the rate of cesarean surgery didn't go down after that was put into place. Where malpractice really does make a difference is in that calculus that I described, the idea of I would rather defend a battery than a malpractice suit, because nobody is going to rule, the jury's not going to decide in favor of this bad and selfish woman who didn't want to have cesarean surgery, but they will rule in favor of a baby who's been damaged in the delivery process.
When it comes to in vitro malpractice insurance, there isn't any. We treat reproductive technology more like cosmetics than therapy, and health insurance companies just don't offer insurance for even the procedures themselves, let alone the possibility that something might go wrong when that happens. But if they were to offer such insurance, I wouldn't be too worried about rates skyrocketing in a way that might even push doctors out of the field or otherwise fear performing these procedures or making them less available. There are at least a couple of, well, first I should say, I can understand the fear insofar as these are intangible and emotionally charged injuries. You can imagine juries awarding very extravagant monetary damages for. But judges can rein them in a couple of ways. One, they can declare as a matter of policy, this is not the sort of case for which recovery is consistent with good policy. So this might be the case, for example, when if people are complaining about a thwarted decision to get a really trivial trait. No, one donor was switched with another, and the difference between them is that one was 2 inches taller, or the one had green eyes, or something like that. Judges might say, we don't permit recovery, and so rein in awards in that way for such trivial qualities because we want parents to be more accepting, or we don't want to promote the idea that parents should be so choosy in their exercise of offspring traits, even if the law allows them to be. The other thing that judges can do, as we do in so many other areas of the law, is to rein in especially capricious or extraordinary jury awards to make them more consistent across cases. And so I think if we do that in these ways, we don't have to worry too much about the awards being so large that insurance rates would be too high or doctors would be unwilling to perform procedures at all.
Can I get a sense of how many people would like to ask questions to people on this panel? All right, you have the floor. Yeah, you.
Thank you. My question is for both Dr. Minkoff and Farah. I'm sorry, I'm butchering your name. I'm sorry. But something you said was the duty of the health of the fetus. I thought that was very interesting because in both the situations that both of you brought up, one was the health of the fetus. Dr. Minkoff, you would not induce 3 days later because there were more risks. So the pregnant woman asked, but you would not induce. And in your example, Farah, she did not want the procedure, but the doctor saw it as their duty for the health of the fetus. So both of you brought up the greater good for the fetus, but sort of lacking the choice on the woman's behalf. So just like curious about the balance between, yes, the health of the fetus, the duty to that medical duty, but also honoring the woman's choice.
I don't see the conflict between what we said. I think we're looking at greater and lesser force of positive autonomy and negative autonomy. I agree we should never override a woman's negative autonomy. I'm very concerned about that case in Staten Island. It's only a few miles from my hospital. Because if the state is saying that there is no protection against coerced cesarean sex, the next thing will be that those who make an ethical stand against coercion are going to be put into a legal jeopardy because they're going to say, the state says you can do it, why didn't you do it? This baby was harmed because you didn't do it. You're now liable, and which pushes us all towards reconsidering whether we should be doing coerced cesarean sex. It's a very dangerous precedent. But there is a difference between respecting a woman's right to say, I have bodily integrity. It is a foundational right in English law since the 19th century and the Human Rights Charter of the UN since 1947, and we all respect that. That's different than saying that I have to take part in doing something to someone that they're demanding that I do that I think will harm a child that is going to be born. That's going to be a little girl, it's going to be a big girl, it's going to be a mother herself. and that's going to happen, then I'm going to take that into consideration.
And exactly that. The law doesn't recognize a duty for obstetricians to be the absolute guarantors of the health of all fetuses. There is a duty to, you know, provide care non-negligently such that a child later born isn't harmed by the care that was provided to the pregnant woman. The question that's really raised in this is who gets to speak for the fetus? And in this case, we're presuming that it gets to be the obstetrician or gets to be the state, when in fact, a big part of the reason why Ms. Dre, or why any woman, refuses to have cesarean surgery is not just for her own sake, but also for that of the child that she's carrying.
Yes.
You've been talking a lot about malpractice, and I remember reading studies a while ago that one of the drives to that has resulted in increased C-sections in this country was efficiency interests in the hospitals. And we're not talking about that, but especially the story you told about in Staten Island seems to me some of the quotes, I assume they're direct quotes from the medical staff, this was not a case where the fetus was at risk, this was a case where the woman was too slow. And from my experience with friends who have repeat C-sections, who don't want to have repeat C-sections, those pregnancies are a bit more complex. It's more complex during labor, it may be slower. And I mean, we're seeing this in other kinds of medical practice that don't deal with pregnant women, but there's also, it seems to me, a real factor here of the way hospitals and perhaps a lot of obstetricians look at their cost basis, and we want to process women in a certain time, and pregnancies that don't move according to that kind of timeline, those women are going to be forced into C-sections, which isn't necessarily a malpractice issue. There's no issue of fetal risk. It's an issue of profit margin in economics. So I don't know if you have any comments about that.
Yeah, the one thing I learned from listening to the discussions this morning is that everybody's trying to change Justice Kennedy's mind. And I heard people say that he is never going to assume that the state legislators are bad actors or have evil intent. So I would take that same perspective. I think as a physician who's conversant with the medical literature, there is a risk with prolonged labor to the mother and the baby. They can get chorioamnionitis, you get chorioamnionitis, the risk of cerebral palsy doubles. It's not a, and there's no person from the hospital, the CFO doesn't sit in my labor and delivery suite and say, you know, that woman's used that room for 3 hours. It's time to move things along. And we are a hospital that has insufficient number of beds with people waiting all the time, but we never would, God willing, we would never move someone for that reason. We have, I think, out of 150 hospitals in the state, the second lowest section rate in the state, partially because we don't have enough operating rooms. So while they're waiting their turn, they give birth. But I have never heard anybody say, now maybe they say it in the corporate offices that you guys are sluggish, and but OB is always a money loser. I mean, obstetrics is a money loser. They do it out of the goodness of their heart and the misguided belief that if they deliver there, they'll bring their grandfather in for his cardiac surgery there. But you know, the typical meeting of all the chairs of the department is the surgeons say, you eat what you kill, the pediatricians say, suffer the small baby, and everybody else points at the obstetrician and say, we don't, you know, you're driving us into the tank here. So I am not familiar, and I certainly travel around a bit, with people getting that pressure at the clinical levels. The clinicians don't feel it. Now, the way they may feel it is, I've got an office full of women waiting in the morning, this isn't going well anyway, I can foresee the future, it's already been 2 hours, we usually wait three, there's nothing's gonna happen the next hour. So we all have motivated reasoning. We all hold things to a different standard depending on whether it comports with our beliefs or disagrees with our beliefs. If it agrees with our beliefs, the standard we ask for is, can I believe this? And you look for anything that goes along with it. Well, the tracing looked a little funny. If it's against our beliefs, the standard of evidence is there anything that will allow me to disbelieve it? So if you want to get to your office, you're busy, you're feeling pressured, you're exhausted, you've been there all night, you may change your thinking. But I don't think it's based on, I'm worried about the good of the hospital's bottom line. And maybe I'm worried about being able to be awake for the surgery if I wait any longer, or I have my own personal financial interest in getting to the office. I mean, there's one other more esteemed colleague in the room. I don't know if he wants to comment on whether he's felt the pressure. David Grimes, on the, no comments?
I would love to respond to that as well and say that while I have never met a physician who doesn't care deeply about their patients, I have, in interviewing hundreds and hundreds of people around the country, heard a lot of things that make me very concerned about exactly what you're saying. And so, for instance, women talk all the time about feeling like they're on the clock as soon as they walk through the hospital doors. And now ACOG in the last, a year and a half ago, put out a great paper, ACOG and the Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine Specialists, called The Safe Prevention of the Primary Cesarean. And one of the things that they do in that paper is review out-of-date, old-fashioned time limits on labor, because they are not any longer, if they were, accurate. And there aren't limits to the amount of time that someone can be in early labor or different stages. And certainly the practices that are rampant across the country, certainly in smaller hospitals, in hospitals that aren't leaders in medical education, where they're not really focused on evidence-based practice, there's both a tremendous amount of variation. There's a lot of, well, we've been doing this forever. And what we've seen is that despite these really good guidelines saying, look, we need to give people a little more time, there aren't good reasons for some of these curtailed limits. We really haven't seen a change yet. And there's a real range. And when people care and are dedicated to evidence-based practices, and there's hospital leadership that takes that into consideration, you see women getting great care, but it is very uneven. And to tie this back around to malpractice very briefly, what we see in the US system is malpractice litigation is relied on as an accountability mechanism. And it doesn't serve that function. There needs to be a way to provide the support and the positive incentives to create policies at different levels of government and facilities to support providers providing the best possible care for all women.
I just want to say, I don't disagree with Nana, someone who's a co-author on that document you cited. I was just saying that the fact that people are going too long is not related to doctors saying, well, my CEO wants me to get this room clean. It's their own personal, what's going on in their lives, what they need to do, and maybe their belief in older standards of care. I just don't attribute it to the CFO telling people, you know, I want a new patient in there every 4 hours.
Is there anyone else who has an urgent question for this panel? Yeah, go on.
For Dr. Minkoff, I just wanted to ask, that story you told about the woman who wanted to give birth sooner after she already knew the baby was going to be like a paraplegic, then the baby would have been blind. Oh, that was a thought experiment? Yes, it wasn't based on a real
case? No child was harmed in the creation of that story.
Oh, great. Okay, I'm glad I asked, so I wouldn't have to worry about him. Thanks.
All right, I just would like to ask my four panelists. Sylvia.
That's almost 5 years.
Sylvia, I'm missing it, and I don't want to miss a word.
Okay, I've been teaching this stuff for a long time. And I've noticed this change in my students, and I don't know if it's just anecdotal or if it reflects something else, but I think in the 70s and early 80s, there were many students who were interested in more natural forms of childbirth and were resentful of the patterns by which they were forced to do all kinds of stuff that you guys have been describing, that Childbirth Connection describes so well. But my perception now is that there's much less interest in that, that there's a sentiment that says, I just want to do it in the quickest, least painful, most high-tech intervention. Well, I see some young people here nodding, like maybe I've said something that was relevant. Do any of you have a sense of whether we've seen a change in the demographics of young women thinking about what they want out of childbirth?
Thank you. Great question.
Well, you know, the three most dangerous words in evidence-based medicine are, in my experience. But for this, I would have to say, in my experience, having actually read about what happened in the 70s since I went to medical school in the 90s. But there certainly was a greater, I think you're absolutely right. Right now, woman comes in to have her baby, the first thing she asks for is where's the anesthesiologist, and they're quite upset if there's a delay of an hour before there's nobody coaching them. We give them plenty of options to have, here's how you breathe in like you're breathing a rose, blah, blah, blah. They're like, I know what I need, bring them in. But there are other, it's a cultural thing. We have people from all over the world, and different people have different expectations and desires, and we try to fulfill people's expectation. But this comes from outside. It's not medicine giving this education. People come to the offices already with expectations, and we have 30 midwives on our staff. So this is a midwife also standard, I guess.
Farah, you want to?
Yeah. Oh, sure. So I don't know that I can speak to trends in whether or not people are more interested in having more natural births. But then again, I'm also not sure whether or not that's the question that matters. I think that what we're seeing is an increase in people who are coming to birth with an understanding that they are rights-bearing persons who deserve to be treated with dignity. And so whatever they ultimately decide for how they give birth or what procedures are going to accept or decline, that they are increasingly frustrated by violations of their right to make those decisions.
Nan, do you?
Yeah, just I think that we see conflicting trends. So I think that expectations around walking in and getting your epidural, absolutely, that seems to be on the rise. But at the same time, you see an increase, a doubling in the tiny percentage of births that are home births. And part of that is that some women want to give birth at home, and part of that is that there are women who have very bad, even traumatic experiences giving birth in hospitals. So it's both positively seeking out that very different experience of a home birth and reactively saying, that's not okay. So I think we're seeing different trends. And also there are media myths that don't turn out to really be reflective of reality. So the one big national survey of women called Listening to Mothers that have looked at the question of, for instance, maternal request cesareans have found that in fact it's a very, very tiny percentage, like 1% or fewer than 1% of women who are the ones who are actively pursuing a cesarean for no reason, and that generally it is physicians who raise that issue first.
You have something you, because we're, Deb, do you want to get into this at all? Did you want to say something? We'll take one quick last question, okay. Here comes your microphone.
Oh, on the insurance side of things, I just want to mention that medical malpractice tends to be regulated at the state level, and so you're dealing with a complex infrastructure of state regulators who have really limited capacity to clamp down on malpractice insurers and their rate setting. But I just want to offer that in my experience working in insurance regulation, there tends to be a fairly large discretionary space in which a regulator that's willing to call in malpractice insurers and require justification of claims-based rate setting can actually have a fair amount of leverage. And I've tried to do that specifically in the abortion space with respect to medication abortion, where you find malpractice insurers setting rates that are astronomical for providers and pricing them out of the market, particularly for family physicians who are willing to provide abortion. And so, the comment just is, please don't, in all of your fantastic advocacy, forget the role of regulators and certain amounts of discretion on the insurance side when recognizing the cost-driving capacity of malpractice rates. So please target your regulators as well.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, the panelists, for a wonderful panel.
What did you call status in that? That was scary. I didn't know that.